Hey, good morning, church. Welcome to the house of the Lord this morning. Would you please stand to your feet with us? We're going to start off together and read our call to worship, which will be on the screen behind me. We ready? Here we go. Okay. O God, who for our redemption gave your only begotten Son to the death of the cross, and by his glorious resurrection delivered us from the power of our enemy, grant us so to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him in the joy of his resurrection. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Let's lift our voices this morning and sing. Christ the Lord is risen today. Sing.
Christ the Lord is risen today.
He is alive. We
thank you, God. He's been so good to us. The song is called My Testimony. It celebrates the things that God has done in our lives.
I saw Satan fall like lightning, and I saw darkness run for cover. But the miracle that I just can't get over, my name is registered in heaven. I've been believing signs and wonders. I have resurrection power. Steer the miracle that I just can't get over. My name is registered in heaven. Yes, my praise belongs to you forever. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony.
Let's come together, sons and daughters.
Born with blood and washed in water. Sing the praises of the Spirit, Son and Father, our God. Finish what he started, that's right. Yes, our God will finish what he started. Oh, this is my testimony from death to life. Grace rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous.
Is faithfulness to us.
If I'm not dead, then you're not done. The greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. The greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. If I'm not dead, then you're not done. The greater things are still to come. Oh, I not dead, you're not done, Lord. Greater things are still to come. Oh, I believe. This is my testimony from death to life. 'Cause Christ rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. Oh, I'm alive. This is my testimony from death to life. Scripture rewrote my story. I'll testify by Jesus Christ the righteous. I'm justified. This is my testimony. This is my testimony. My testimony.
Good morning, River City Church. He is risen. Amen. We have such joy and hope today because of what was accomplished on the cross so many years ago. And so I'm going to just take this bit of time to welcome each and every one of you to River City Church. We're glad you're here. Let's take just a minute to let our neighbors know we're glad to see them and wish them a happy Easter.
Thank you. so nice to meet you. You guys sound fantastic.
It works.
Now you have to bring it all together.
All right, River City Church. So as we head back to our seats, my name is Clay, and I'm one of the pastors here at River City Church, and I get the privilege and opportunity of welcoming each and every one of you to service with us today. Whether you're a first-time guest or you're a long-time member, we have prayed for you, we have planned for you, and we are excited to be able to serve you. And some of the ways that we can serve you are by helping you get connected to the body, connected to each other. And an easy way to do that is to look at the seat back of the pew in front of you. We have a Connect card. On that Connect card, there's a bunch of information that you can fill out. We're not going to creep you or send you scam emails or spam emails, whatever you get in your email folder that you don't want. We just want to find ways to help you get connected. So fill out that information as much as you're comfortable with. Place that in the faith box at the back of the worship center on your way out, and somebody from the church will follow up with you. If you have a prayer request, if you'd like to get connected to a team, if you've got questions about classes, Sunday school, anything like that, put it on that card. We would love to be able to help you. And so talking about just a few ways we can be connected, get connected, stay connected, I've got just a few announcements. Number one, if you'll notice, there's a new QR code. Now, for those of you who are my age and older, that's a QR code. You can take your phone out, if you have an iPhone or an Android, and you scan that with your camera, a link will come up. You can click that, and it will take you to our link tree. Because I know if you are someone like me, you're like, I wish there was just one space that I could find all the things. We hear you. This link tree, if you scan that QR code, it's going to take you to where you can see resources, the church directory, announcements, the current newsletter. All of those things are consolidated to one space, so you don't have to go all over the place to find things. So that's the new QR code. My second announcement is yesterday we had our Easter carnival where we got to serve our community. And I don't know if there's pictures. We served, I would say a conservative estimate would be 500 family units. So that's 500 parents plus kids. Yes. I know that we had enough cotton candy for 400 and we ran out of that pretty quickly. So lots of cotton candy was distributed yesterday. But more importantly, we got to pour into people that were not connected to River City Church and show them Jesus. That's the whole name of the game. That's the whole reason we do what we do. And we couldn't do that without volunteers. It doesn't happen without you guys. I could have all the greatest ideas in the world, and I would be out there by myself were it not for the faithful being the hands and feet of Jesus. And so I want to just talk about a couple of them. The entire team, we couldn't do without. But there's one lady who stuffed, I don't know, at least 1,000 eggs by herself. Miss Jeanette Sanger. She would kill me if she knew. Yes. I can't express enough how much she did for us. Typically, when you have to stuff eggs, I have to kind of come up, tell in Charlie, and finish up. We had all the eggs stuffed. We bought more eggs. She stuffed all of those eggs. This lady is a machine, so thank you, Miss Jeanette. And then we had a couple of little ladies yesterday who were old enough to participate in the event, but instead chose to serve. And that's Pat Beard's granddaughters, Cora, and I'm sorry, I'm terrible with names, but Cora and her sister. They made popcorn, and they did an excellent job. Yes. So again, it's a testament to who we are as a church that our people go out and they serve the least, the last, and the lost. And so thank you from the bottom of my heart. During that carnival, we had a giveaway. And we were giving away some switches and some tricycles. And we told everybody, sign up, it's free, but you got to be at church tomorrow to win it. So today, the rubber meets the road. We're gonna do the drawings for those prizes. Now, if you win, you can meet me in the lobby after service, and I will make sure you get your prize. I'm going to go through the list. I've got several names. Hopefully, we don't get through all of these. If someone is here, that would be awful. But number one, for the tricycles, our first winner is Kiera Stanford. Is Kiera Stanford here? All right. Marley Frazier. Tyson Waugh. All right, hey, Tyson, meet me in the lobby after this, and I will hook you up, my friend. We've got one more trike to give away. Do we have a Parker Prickett here? How about a Leo Fanastil? All right. Perfect. So you guys meet me in the lobby, and we'll get you your trikes after service. And now then, for our older kids, we've got Nintendo Switches. And apparently they're super special Animal Crossing editions, whatever that means. Number one, Valerie Van Landingham. Do we have her in the house or any representative? Trey McKinney. Elijah Chase. Do we have an Elijah Chase? All right. Sweet. So if you, again, if you'll meet me out in the lobby. And then one more, Maverick Redinger. I hear names. No? Anybody can get it to him? No, got it. Loud and clear, loud and clear. Alexis Williams. All right, we got one more. Harper Kesey. Yes? Awesome. Hey, we keep trying. We're going to get it. All right, if y'all will meet me in the lobby, we will take care of that. Awesome. So those are the announcements I have for today. We're going to continue along in worship. If you guys would pray with me just one second, we'll continue in worship. Father, we thank you today. We thank you for all that you have done for us, all that you accomplished through your son, Jesus. We didn't deserve it, Father. There was such a gap that we could not cross, and you stepped down amongst us, suffered, bled, and died so that we could be right before you. Words can't express the gratitude that we have today for your gift and your grace. It's in your son's holy name that we pray. Amen.
Would you please join me again by standing up? We're going to lift our voices and sing this wonderful old song, Because He Lives.
God sent His Son. They called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died by my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives.
And then one day,
I'll cross that river, I'll find life's final war within. And then as death gives way to victory, I'll see the lights of glory and I'll know He lives. Because He lives, because He lives, I can face.
Thank you, God. Make that our prayer, God. Thank you, God, for your reign.
So I'll raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. To fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope is arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive.
With everything inside of me, I'll raise a hallelujah. Yes. I will watch the darkness flee. I'll raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery.
Amen. Happy Easter. So, some of you might be new here like myself. My family just moved here a couple weeks ago. Last week was our first Sunday. This being my second Sunday here, I'm sure there are things that I am still learning just about being in the Midwest. I moved here from Florida. And just before I moved, my family, we went out to a pizza place, and I ordered a pop. And the waitress laughed at me and said, "You're not from here." And I realized, even though I had been there for 11 years, it was still soda down there. What do you call it? Yes, I'm home. Thank you, God. There are other things like, I'm sure you guys can fill me in on a lot of the things, but there are some that I've found are universal, like God is good and all the time. Amen. That one, they say it the same in Florida, in Washington. They say it in a different language, but probably the same thing in other countries too. But here's one that I've found some people within the church know and some don't necessarily. So I'm going to try something here. He is risen. Okay, you guys know that one. One of my favorite responses was many years ago. There was somebody who did not know the response, but believed in Jesus. And so it was said, "He is risen." And he said, "You got that right." You got it right. And you are here this morning to celebrate that he is risen indeed. And so as we are here today, whether you're new or you've been here for 150 years, if so, we need to talk and see what sort of diet you're eating. But many have been here for a long time. Some, this is your first time here. Welcome. This is an imperfect church filled with imperfect people following a perfect God who forgives us, restores us, and gives us the opportunity to walk in relationship with him. So today we have a unique opportunity to gather in a potentially dangerous place to hear a potentially dangerous message brought to us by a very safe and yet terrifying God. I love in C.S. Lewis, in the Chronicles of Narnia, when they meet the lion, he said, "Well, is he safe?" And the response was, "No, he's absolutely not safe. He's a lion, but he's good." God, the creator and sustainer of all things, came to earth for us. And what's amazing is that as we celebrate Easter, we're celebrating the greatest day in all of history. All of history. And we are able to boil it all down to one incredible day and worship and celebrate. I want to read for you very quickly. Romans 5:18 says, "Consequently, just as one trespass resulted in condemnation for all people, so also one righteous act resulted in justification and life for all people." So we're looking today at not only the cross, but the empty tomb. But to do so, we need to rewind all the way back to the beginning of creation and look at a little bit of creation and the pattern throughout history, and also take a look at what some relationships are between the Garden of Eden and creation and even the cross. Rabbi Jason Sobel offers some interesting perspectives from a Hebrew perspective, looking at the original Garden of Eden, living in creation, living perfectly with God, and what just happened, what we've celebrated this week. So Jesus died on a tree. Man stole from a tree. Jesus' hands were pierced. Man stole from the tree with his hands upon the fruit. Jesus was pierced in his side. Eve came from Adam's side. The crown of thorns was placed on his head. The curse of sin was a curse that the ground would produce thorns and thistles. On the cross, Jesus took upon the curse of us, and he reversed it all, taking upon his shoulders the curse that was upon all mankind and reconciling us to God. So throughout all of history, we look at the creation. God made man and woman in his image. In the image of God, he created them. As God created, we don't know how long they were in the Garden of Eden. We know the creation account and the story of what was going on in the garden, and it was perfect. Adam and Eve were with God, and they were without sin. It was perfect. But if you know the story, they ate from the tree of knowledge of good and evil. And so this pattern is a pattern of creation and then the fall. And then there's a pattern of God trying to teach humankind to rely on him. But in doing so, we as humankind tend to get very selfish. And as selfish beings, we took our eyes off of God and trusted in self. And so when you look through the Old Testament of the Bible, a lot of that, if you look at the big picture, it's a cyclical pattern of trust in God and then take our eyes off of God and trust in self. When you look even to the side of the Israelites being taken out of slavery within Egypt, they went out to the wilderness for 40 years. That was the wilderness school. That should have been the training for them to how to rely upon God. In fact, every morning they would wake up and there was on the ground something called manna. Now, manna literally means, what is it? Because it wasn't known, but it was edible. It was sustenance. I don't know how they cooked it. I don't know what it tasted like. Well, everything tastes like chicken, so it must have been somewhat chicken-like. So manna, they would wake up in the morning, and on the ground was this manna. And as they would consume it throughout the day, they would have their sustenance. If they got selfish and stored up more than they needed, it would spoil. God was teaching them that they don't need more than what he provides. They need him. And so this went on for 40 years. You'd think after 40 years, you'd learn something, right? But as soon as they exited the wilderness school and they went into the promised land, they started crying out for, no, we want a king. We want someone to lead us. Yeah, we learned about trusting in God, but now that's over. Now we need a king, a person to follow, and we need human leadership. And this same type of cycle happened over and over. But this pattern, and even though it kept going and kept going and kept going, finally what God had to do was say, you have a curse upon you because of not trusting me. Taking your eyes off of God means that we turn our eyes to self. By looking to self, we have an obligation to repent from that. And when we repent from that which we call sin, that separates us from God, you have to atone for that wrong. We cannot atone for it on our own. When we atone for sin, it means that something must be sacrificed for us to make the wrongs right. To think about in terms of accounting, there's a debt and an income column. And for them to be in balance, there's something that has to be done to bring them in balance. And the same is for us, that if you do one thing wrong in your life, that tips the scales to the side of automatically deserving death and hell. But even one thing, no matter how many things you do wrong, all of them can be rectified, can be reconciled by the payment on our behalf by Jesus Christ. So God himself came down from heaven, lived along on the earth, lived a perfect life, was sacrificed. Friday night, we had a great time celebrating and remembering and reflecting on Good Friday. And we call it good because we know Sunday comes, and we know that Jesus overcame death, rose on the third day, and that tomb is empty. So we can call it Good Friday. But it's difficult because what Jesus did was humiliating. He lowered himself to a level that was unimaginable. And by following a method and form of humility, he lowered himself to a way that we can come to him and appreciate that he did something that we cannot do on our own. And by being crucified on the cross, sacrificed for us, what he did was exemplify himself as the good shepherd who went into the pen, opened the gate, and called his sheep to follow him out. Now, last week, if you were here, I did something that I hurt my hip doing. Jesus on Palm Sunday entered on a baby donkey, a foal, the foal of a donkey. So I tried coming in on a tricycle. I'm not incredibly tall, but that tricycle was really small. And I kind of hurt my hip doing it, but I got over it. It's okay. But when we look to what Jesus did, he lowered himself to the very bottom, humiliating, embarrassing stage within mankind and opened the gate for us. What ends up happening for us, though, is that we're able to follow him. And so I want to look, if you have your Bibles, you can turn with me to John 10. We're going to look in John 10 today. You might have your phones on there, too. It's also going to be on the screen if you want to read along. But we're looking at John 10, starting in verse 1. Lord Jesus, as we dig into your scripture, I ask right now that you would bring these words to life, that these would not just be words, but this would be your Holy Spirit speaking to us right now. In the precious name of Jesus, we pray. Amen. Very truly, I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheep pen by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. So I was sharing how I came in on a tricycle last week, and I shared about how Jesus came in on a baby donkey. And then after service, now I know I'm in a different area. In Florida, we don't have a lot of farms in the area that I lived in. Here, some of you know farming, know animals, and I was so blessed that somebody came up and explained to me the age of a colt is from 6 months to 2 years, and a foal would be a six-month-old. So it was great to understand what farmers and people who know animals, which I know about dogs, you feed them and you let them outside and that's about it, right? But all these other farm animals, they're new to me. And so what I ended up doing was being blessed by somebody who shared this is the age. And so to understand that this was a baby donkey was both humiliating and also educational. I also don't know about sheep. Anyone here a sheep farmer? Okay, we're in good company then. There are areas where people do farm sheep. And in the time of Jesus, sheep farming was common. And Jesus would use elements of the area that they could understand. And so we understand that all like sheep have gone astray. We understand these phrases and we picture a sheep, but how many of us really understand what it means to hear the voice of the master as a sheep? Well, I want to share this video that I found a while back that is about calling your sheep.
One more time.
They're coming. Oh my God. Oh my
that cool or what? Yeah. You will never have the same again.
How can we leave the video coming?
When you know the voice of your master, you respond in a different way. It's amazing to hear that all of these others were trying to call. They were giving it their best, but the sheep just ignored them. But then their master, their shepherd, just spoke like he had done many times before, and those sheep responded. And as he entered the gate, they came to him. So when Jesus was talking to the people about sheep, they would have understood like this. And yet the religious leaders of the time were baffled by it and still didn't understand it. But I want us to understand through this type of lens when we're reading this scripture in John. Because he goes on and he says, Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees, the religious leaders, they did not understand what he was telling them. They were likely really learned and studied in scripture, but they were not out on the farm very often knowing what the sheep were doing and knowing, what are you talking about, Jesus? They're going to follow a shepherd? Huh? But we are able to see that Jesus, being the good shepherd, was calling all who would hear his voice to him. So therefore, Jesus said again, very truly, I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out, and they will find pasture. Now, this word we might understand, but a pasture is a field where we can find sustenance. You find good food, you find the water that's necessary, you find safety. In the pasture is where we are intended to live. Unfortunately, we live in a world that is far from the pasture God wants for us. We live in a world that is more commonly run by a government, more commonly run by self, humanity, rather than trusting in God. And I'm not going to get political because that is not at all what we're here for. But anything that turns our eyes to humanity more than God is missing the pasture. And that is why God came down, the good shepherd came to his sheep and said, come, follow me. I am the gate. If you come through me, you can experience the kingdom come on earth as it is in heaven. And so he goes on and he says, the thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. That is the world we're living in. When we turn our trust to anything in the world, it is going to steal and kill and destroy. But when we turn our trust to God, he has come that we may have life and have it to the full. He says, I am the good shepherd. No, this is scripture. This is not me. I am not the good shepherd. I'm just another sheep following the good shepherd. So as I read this, hear Jesus' words. He is the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. In fact, he knows how many hairs are on our head. Now for me, he's not having to count nearly as high as he used to. That bald factor just comes on and it makes it easier for him to count. But he knows every little detail for us. And in doing that, he also knows all of our needs, all of our concerns, and everything that we don't know that we need. He knows. So he says, I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep. That's us. So he was talking to this group of people that was in a specific time. God knew all of history and all of time. And so he's referring to us when he says, I have other sheep that are not of this sheep pen. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me. No one can take God's life from him. He had to voluntarily lay down his life for us. And he laid it down of his own accord. And he says he has authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. And this command he received from his Father. So we're looking today, and this sermon series that we're going into for a season is called Purpose Matters. And today we're looking at Jesus is risen for a purpose. Now that purpose, if we look at the cycle throughout history, throughout the Old Testament, that was to teach humanity to trust in him. And he even got as far as sacrificing his own only begotten son that we could follow him out of the wilderness into the pasture. And the only way to get into the pasture is through the gate. The gate is Jesus himself. And by following Jesus himself into that gate, we are fulfilling his purpose for coming to earth. Why did he die? So that he could defeat death once and for all. And as Jesus defeated death, he burst open a Jesus-shaped hole out of hell. That the only way to get out of hell is to go through Jesus, the gate into the pasture, his perfect relationship with us. Now, the unique part is that we're still alive here on earth. And so even as we are followers of Jesus, we are still here. Why don't we just go through the gate and we ascend to heaven right away? Well, that would be great, because when you hurt your hip, when you get dunked in really, really cold water, there are times you're going, there's a lot of suffering here right now, God. And granted, cold water is not that big of a suffer. But I know so many who have been fighting through cancer, financial struggles, relational struggles. All of the struggles that we have, wouldn't it just be easier if we could go through the gate, Jesus? And boom, we're in heaven. We're here for a purpose too. Jesus' purpose was to create the gate that we could come through. Our job is to go through the gate and to see heaven come to earth, a new creation. Let the old be gone and the new come. So our citizenship then becomes citizens of heaven. But if you know what an ambassador is, if you know an ambassador from the United States might go to another country, they go into a specific area. This building is set aside. This building is uniquely set aside, not governed by the area that it is within. That is called an embassy. In the world here, they call it an embassy. We send ambassadors to other countries to live in those embassies. You could think of this as an embassy for the kingdom of God. When we leave here, we are in the world. Our citizenship, if we know and accept the gift of grace from Jesus, then we are no longer citizens of this world. We're citizens of the kingdom of heaven. And what we do here is as representatives of that kingdom to this world around us. And so as ambassadors for him, we fulfill our purpose by sharing the message that he shared with us, sharing that message with others. And so in John 12, Jesus says, whoever serves me must follow me. And where I am, my servant also will be. My Father will honor the one who serves me. Now my soul is troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. No, it was for this very reason that I came to this hour. Father, glorify your name. Then a voice came from heaven. I have glorified it and will glorify it again. So this is Jesus talking with God right before he would be crucified. And what he is saying is, God, Father, I don't want to go through this. He knew what pain was awaiting him and torture in humility. And yet he said, not for me, but that you would be glorified. Do you ever have a conversation with someone where you say, I don't want to share about Jesus because they might look at me weird? We live in an area where if I talk about God, then they're just going to think this is how I vote, or this is how I think about them, or this is how I look down on them. if we humble ourselves like Jesus did, then when we serve and love, then hopefully they're going to see the love of Jesus, not the individual before them. But we have to humble ourselves, and we have to boldly and bravely, courageously step out and say, not my will, not my pride, not myself, but God, please work through me. Because Jesus, when he died, he was humiliated. It was a terrible, humiliating, painful, long, terrible way to die. But Sunday came, and he opened up a gate right out of hell that we can follow him and we can come to this pasture, the new creation that God has for us. And in doing so, he even then went and he lived among the people for over a month with the people, spending time with them, letting them touch him, see his scars, eat with them. He was making it very clear that he was not some scary ghost walking around, some spirit that was just of a different world and temporarily here. He was a new creation, recognizable and yet not recognizable. There were some weird things going on, and we have that to look forward to, that someday we will have a new body. Oh, my back is so grateful for that. My knees are grateful for that. Someday we will be able to have a perfect body, live in a perfect pasture, and have the perfect good shepherd watching over us. Well, he's here now watching over us. Jesus is alive. In fact, in Luke 24:39, he said, look at my hands and my feet. It is I myself. Touch me and see. A ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see I have. See, Jesus, what he was doing was exemplifying a new way to live. And we have that now to follow out of that gate. If you today have strayed from the pasture, if you maybe are finding yourself in a place where this doesn't feel like the place where God wants me to be, Jesus is alive. He came to this earth. He defeated death and hell, and he opened up hell with a gate, very specific shaped gate, the shape of Jesus himself, that the only way out of hell is through Jesus. And so this morning, maybe you feel distant from God. Maybe you've never had a relationship with God. I want to create an opportunity for us to say, yes, God, thank you for sacrificing for me. I accept your payment on my behalf. And so right now, would you just, because this is not about who's around and getting, oh, that person, I'm going to tell so-and-so that I saw them raise their hand. But I just want you to have a moment with God, not those around you. So would you just, with your head bowed, your eyes closed, would you just pray with me? If you've prayed this before, just let it be a reminder for you. If it's been a long time and you feel distant from God, let this be the cry of your soul, cry of your heart. If you've never said this, let these words follow closely in your heart. And you can just repeat after me. You can say it in your head. But I want you to communicate with God right now and say, Heavenly Father, I know that I am not where you want me to be. I am distant from you. I need forgiveness. I need you. I need your grace, your love. I need the good shepherd. Jesus, please forgive me. Please show me what it is like to live a life that you intend for me. God, I want to go out of the wilderness through the gate of Jesus into the safe pasture. Allow me to eat and live the way you want. And with the heads bowed still and eyes closed, I just want to know how I can pray for you. And if you prayed that prayer with me, if it was the first time, if it was a recommitment, if it was a reminder for yourself, I just want to make eye contact with you so that I can lift you up to God. Because the enemy does not want this. So if you did, would you just shoot your arm up, your hand up, and yes, I see you, sir. I see you. Yeah, I see you in the back. I see you up here, young lady. I see you. Oh, yes, I see you, ladies. I see you. I see you, sir. I see you, ma'am. I see you, ladies. As we are committing our life to God, see, I know the enemy does not want this morning to happen. You don't know, hopefully, those who were here this morning. You can go ahead and just raise your eyes, raise your heads. You see that screen up there? This morning it didn't work. There were things with the sound, they didn't work. There were things that just were not working this morning. I love those mornings. They're stressful. They're a little panicky. But when enough things go wrong, it tells me the enemy is scared. And he does not want change to happen. See, he is very comfortable if you would be comfortable. If you would just live a life that is just lukewarm, not commit yourself to Christ. If you would just go through the motions, he loves that. Because you're not doing much for God. But when we commit our life to God, we get off the bench. When we get into the game, Satan does not like that. God loves it. And so if Satan could distract us in any way he could this morning, he would do so. And he tried, but we prayed over the service. Now maybe you saw glitches and things that were, oh, why is the video doing that? Or why is this? And Jesus is here. The presence of God is here this morning, and we have the opportunity to worship him, celebrate the greatest day in all of history. Amen? And as we do so, we also get to praise and worship. So I want to ask, if you're able to, would you stand with us? If you are more comfortable sitting, that's great, and just raise a hand, but just say, Jesus, thank you for your grace. Thank you for being here today. Thank you for sending your son, Father. He is risen.
So God sent his son. They called him Jesus. He came to love, heal, and forgive. He lived and died by my pardon. An empty grave is there to prove my Savior lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Just because he lived one day, and then one day I'll cross that river, I'll fight life's fight, no more with pain. And then as day gives way to victory, I'll see the light of glory and on all he lives. Because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know is worth the living just because he lives.
It's worth the living because we are able to get out of death and go through the gate that is Jesus out into the pasture. May his kingdom come, his will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Today, we get to go from this place celebrating the greatest day in history, but it does not end here. See, if you go from this place and you just say, well, that was an all right service, and hey, we got to see the new guy, and we got to see things happen. If an ambassador goes into the embassy, does all the work in the embassy, and then goes out into the community and forgets everything that they did in the embassy, they're going to lose their job. They're not going to be the ambassador for much longer. They're going to come back to the country they're sent from. We are ambassadors for the kingdom of God. When we go from this place, we have an obligation to represent that kingdom. Yes, we're going to mess up. We're not going to represent it perfectly because while we are saved, we are also still human. God knows that. He's still going to work in spite of our mess ups. So go and bravely, boldly speak out like Jesus. Serve like Jesus. Be humble like Jesus. And so, with the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, having overcome death and sin, we go from this place able to serve and love likewise. God bless you all. Have a wonderful Easter and ambassadorship. God bless you.